This behind me is a Cirrus SR22. It's a small single-engine plane, but it can travel at speeds at over 180 miles an hour.
And installed in the baggage compartment in the back of this aircraft is this. This is a Starlink receiver.
Some modern aircraft like this Cirrus SR22, this is a G6 version, it's only a couple of years old, already have satellite capabilities built in. In fact, this one does. You can send and receive satellite phone calls from this aircraft. You can receive data via the satellite connection it already has installed. So knowing that's already built into some aircraft like this, why then would you bother installing Starlink? It all comes down to functionality. Whereas the GSR56, currently installed in the Cirrus SR22, uses the Iridium network to send and receive data from satellites, Starlink, which we've put in the Cirrus SR22, uses the Starlink network, again to send and receive data to and from satellites. But whereas the GSR56 and the Iridium network is limited to the types of data it can send and receive, the Starlink network is basically just internet in your plane. It's only limited to what you can do on the devices that you connect to it. So whatever you can do with a device like an iPhone or an iPad, I don't have an iPad with me, but whatever you could do on a device like this when you're on the ground using the internet, you can now do exactly the same using these devices. The only difference is you can do it up in the air. Up there.
And my friend Andrew, who owns the aircraft that we're actually going to take flying in a second, has a very important trip coming up where an always-on internet connection is going to be very useful indeed.
You've got a trip coming up as well, Andrew, where you're going to be doing a lot of flying in remote Australia. Is that another reason why you've put Starlink on this?
Yeah, absolutely. For my normal flights, my satellite phone and the weather I get from that is perfectly fine. But I'm going around Australia, I'm circumnavigating Australia for Fly for the Kids to raise money for the Children's Hospital for a precision medicine centre which will include gene therapy, dedicated beds at the hospital. So that's the purpose of the flight. So I'll be flying in remote areas in Western Australia, South Australia, Northern Territory, where depending on what altitude I might not be able to talk to people, where I've got this as a backup for weather, phone calls. There's nothing better than having your home internet with you in the aeroplane to actually come along on this wonderful trip.
Give me some stats. How long is it going to take you? Do you know how many stops you're going to make?
I think there's 40 odd stops. So it'll be 3 weeks. I think it's about 18,000 nautical miles, so close enough to 35,000 kilometres. Visiting families that I look after around Australia, and also just spreading the word for this actual flight and the reasons why we're doing it.
How can we track you?
So there's two ways to track me. The place to go is Fly for the Kids, www.flyforthekids.org.au. It has all the information about why we're doing this, some patient stories, an active link tracking me around Australia at all times. So that's the place to go.
So I want to see how Starlink performs in real life. So Andrew and I are going to go for a flight in his Starlink-equipped Cirrus SR22 around Melbourne to see if the connection can keep up, but also to see what kind of connection speeds we can get whilst we're flying.
All right, so just whilst Andrew's getting the aircraft ready, what I'm going to do is just connect to the Starlink dish just to see what sort of speeds we get, first of all, here on the ground. All right, so now I'm connected to your Wi-Fi. So I've got airplane mode on at the top here, so you can see. So we've got no mobile data. So the only data that's coming down to this phone now is purely from the dish. Very cool. All right.
Private aviation users have a few options with Starlink then when it comes to cost. Now, first of all, you've got to buy the Starlink mini receiver. And here in Australia at the moment, that's going to cost you $599. Once you've got your receiver, you then need to decide what sort of plan you have. And with aviation, there are a few different options. They start with plans for slower aircraft, which are really only flying over land, so not going over water, and within one country, to slightly faster aircraft that are flying over land and maybe also doing ocean crossings as well, and all the way up to what I can only imagine is fast private jets flying internationally over land and sea. But because we're a smaller aircraft and Andrew's only really using this within Australia at the moment, we're using what's called the local priority plan, which allows usage within one country. You can't take it over water, but you can take it up to speeds of 350 miles per hour. So in theory, it should be able to keep up with us, right?
So we're just taxiing out to the run-up bay now. I've just run a quick speed test on that. So 141.9 megabits download just here on the ground. For download speeds, we're getting at the moment a 9.09 megabits per second upload speed here on the ground in Moorabbin. But what we'll do is, Andrew will get the aircraft ready, and we're just going to go for a short 15-minute flight just down to the southern side of Melbourne just to see how this performs in the air, especially taking into account that this Cirrus SR22 Turbo that we're flying is actually a very fast aircraft. So can this Starlink keep up with this aircraft? It's one thing for it to get a good fast connection here on the ground, but what's that connection like when we're actually up in the air?
8 Alpha Kilo, clear for takeoff, when ready, make right turn.
Clear for takeoff with right turn, 8 Alpha Kilo.
We are passing 1,100 feet. Andrew is climbing us up now to 3,500 feet. So just because we're moving now, I'm going to run another speed test here on the phone to see what Starlink's actually going to give us when the aircraft's actually moving. And already it's faster. It's probably because we're away maybe from the buildings, or I don't know what it is, but away from the ground. But 228 megabits per second download. Annoyingly faster, like I said, than my home internet, and 12.9 upload speed. Actually, that's very good from a mobile satellite-based unit to get a good upload speed like that. And as we climb in the Cirrus, climbing at around normally 120 knots, so you're looking at something like, well, ground speed actually we should look at is 136. We've got a bit of wind behind us. So you're already looking at something like 140, 150 miles an hour across the ground that we're currently traveling, and yet still getting almost 230 megabits per second download. That's pretty impressive.
This is a beautiful plane. I love it.
Yeah. It's climbing well.
I'm not even pushing it, to be honest.
Well, you're climbing at 130. That's good as well. Yeah. You're getting 1,300 at 130 with two of us. And full tanks?
Yeah. Full tanks, yep. Yeah.
And we've leveled off now. What are we at, Andrew? 3.5?
Close enough, yeah.
Yeah, 3,500 feet. Cirrus is just accelerating a little bit. We'll probably stay around about 150 knots true airspeed, just back on the power a little bit whilst we're here over Melbourne. And we've got a ground speed, though, importantly, because we've got a tailwind here. So ground speed of 160 knots. I'll put some conversions up on the screen for you. So this is the one I was most interested in, because this is pretty much the general use case scenario of how you're going to be using this, Andrew, when you're travelling around. Is sitting up here in the cruise and trying to get things like weather information. I can already tell it's fast. I can already see it going all the way up. It's already very impressive. I mean, look at that. 174 just from that test. You've said in the past you've got like over 200 from this,
yeah,
as well.
I think it probably matters how many people are using Starlink with the satellites. So, you know, going to Griffith or Wagga, that's where there's no one using it out there. So get it. So.
Yeah, good point, actually. We are over a pretty bit built-up area of Melbourne here at the moment. And I think Starlink is being rolled out more aggressively here in Australia as well. And I've anecdotally spoken to a few people who are looking to use it as their main home internet as well. So I think, yeah, as time goes on, that will increase. But the main use case for this, like Andrew was saying, is really remote areas. So I think if you're getting speeds like this over the cities, when you're out over the outback and you're one of the only ones using that satellite connection, it's more than enough for what you need, right?
Absolutely. Even more.
Even more.
Now, one question you may have at this point is, do you actually need to get approval to install a system like this inside an aircraft? Well, thankfully, in this instance, no, because nothing is actually attached to the aircraft itself. The Starlink dish is simply mounted on a pilot removable temporary stand that sits in the baggage compartment. You can treat it the same basically as just putting a bag in the baggage compartment. It's not obstructing any flight controls. It's not obstructing your view out the front. It doesn't get in the way if you're getting in or out of the aircraft. It's just an item that sits in the back, minding its own business, pumping out very fast internet whilst you concentrate on flying.
So I wasn't going to put this in, but Andrew is just descending us down now to get us into Moorabbin, and he just said, what have you got in terms of speed? Because we're descending, so we're actually going a little bit faster. 282.1. So that's the fastest we've had so far in this aircraft. So I think the resounding answer to the question, can Starlink keep up with a fast aircraft like this, is, well, clearly yes.
So how many dropouts did we have on this flight? Well, I had Starlink connected to my phone for the entire flight, and we had a total of Zero dropouts.
Look at the city as well, Andrew. That's gorgeous.
Yeah, I didn't lose the connection once, but admittedly, this was only a quick flight. We were up in the air for around 20 minutes. So it will be interesting to see how this system performs during Andrew's trip when he's flying longer legs over more remote parts of Australia.
8 Alpha Kilo cleared, visual approach, follow a Seminole, early base.
But using the Google speed test tool in flight, I did manage to record download speeds ranging from 141 at the slowest end to 282 megabits per second at the fastest point. But after all that, one thing's for sure.
8 Alpha Kilo, you're now number one.
It is pretty amazing to think that you can get mobile internet at speeds faster than most of us get to our homes here in Australia when you are thousands of feet in the air in a private aeroplane, cruising through the skies at hundreds of miles per hour. Check out this next video right here. I think you'll really like this one. Thanks for watching.